Hi all, in this video I'll be going over the ePWM Type 5 features. These features were implemented to allow for more flexibility in waveform generation and additional safety features. The Type 5 main feature set includes the XCMP complex waveform generator mode, which will provide more flexibility on PWM waveform generation. There are additional safety features which will be found in two added submodules called Diode Emulation, Minimum Deadband, and Illegal Combinational Logic. On top of the already existing Type 4 ePWM Digital Compare, the Digital Compare submodule has an additional safety feature called Event Detection. Every PWM module will have these new features. Now let's dive into the XCMP Waveform Generator mode. The ePWM Extended Compare, or XCMP Complex Waveform Generator mode, when enabled, will provide a way to generate complex waveforms without CPU overhead. With XCMP mode, we can now generate up to 4 pulses within 1 ePWM period, which means we can increase our PWM frequency up to 4 times. Generating more than 1 pulse within a period is done through the additional registers added for counter compare, time-based period, and action qualifier registers. CMPA and CMPB will share the 8 extended or XCMP registers either by allocating all registers to CMPA or splitting the registers between CMPA and CMPB. There are also 8 extended action qualifiers to configure an action to occur when the time-based counter is equal to one of the XCMP registers. In Type 4, we had just one level of shadowing our active registers. Now, in Type 5, there are up to 3 shadow register sets which exist for CMPA, CMPB, CMPC, and CMPD, as well as our time-based period and our action qualifier settings. When XCMP mode is disabled, the ePWM module will behave like Type 4 ePWM. Now let's take a look at an example of this mode along with the loading schemes from shadow to active. For this example, we have our extended time-based period and split the extended compare registers between PWM-A and PWM-B. 4 of the XCMP registers will be allocated to PWM-A, and the other 4 will be going to PWM-B. For each XCMP value, we can have an XAQ action to occur to toggle PWM-A and PWM-B. With XCMP mode, we are able to generate 2 pulses within the period for both PWM-A and PWM-B. The CMPA and CMPB registers will reflect what is in the XCMP active registers during execution. Now let's look at the loading schemes when this mode is enabled. Type 5 shadow loading, as discussed before, will have up to 3 shadow register sets. There is configurability to set the number of shadow register sets to use. For example, you can have no shadow sets, 1 shadow set, 2 shadow sets, or 3 shadow register sets. You can repeat shadow register set 3 up to 8 times, and the same applies for shadow register set 2. Each shadow register set is able to hold different values. This provides more flexibility with generating different waveforms occurring each period. The shadow register sets get loaded only at one event, and this is when time-based counter equals to 0. All 8 or a subset of 8 of the XCMP values may be used within one period. Next, we will discuss the Diode Emulation submodule. One of the safety features added for Type 5 is Diode Emulation. The Diode Emulation submodule will work in conjunction with the CMPSS by driving the output to a known state based on an event occurring on input crossbar, CMPSS trip H or low signals, or the CLB input crossbar. Within the Diode Emulation submodule, there is a way to detect the duration when Diode Emulation is active, and generate a trip from that if the Diode Emulation has been active for too long. There is also ability to add delay before re-entering Diode Emulation. An example of using the submodule would be having the ability to detect overcurrent scenarios and drive the PWM outputs to a safe state before resuming normal operation. In the waveform, the red is the current signal. When the signal reaches the CMPSS DAC val H1, Diode Emulation mode becomes active and the CMPSS's DAC val H and DAC val L will be loaded with a new value from the Diode Emulation. When the current signal reaches normal operation, the CMPSS DAC valve will be the original DAC valve H1 and DAC valve L1. When diode emulation becomes active, the PWM outputs will be driven to a known state of trip H, trip L, high or low. When diode emulation mode becomes active, the PWM outputs will be driven to a known state. Let's take a look at a waveform example of what happens during diode emulation mode. First, a trip must be detected on the trip H or trip L signal. This signal is simply an OR between trip H and trip L. Second, diode emulation mode is active when it is indicated by the DE active flag. Third and fourth, the output of EPWM XA underscore DE follows trip L. The output of EPWM XB underscore DE follows trip H. And PWMB from the diode emulation block is set to match the state of trip L and trip H respectively. The minimum deadband and illegal combo logic submodule have been added to provide additional security features. The main benefits of these submodules are the prevention of shorts occurring and having unwanted output combinations. The minimum deadband and the illegal combo logic will come after the diode emulation. The minimum deadband submodule will insert a minimum delay between EPWM outputs based on the falling edges of the outputs. The illegal combo logic submodule will prevent combinations of EPWM outputs from occurring by setting them to a known state. From the block diagram, there are two crossbars named minimum deadband crossbar and illegal combinational logic X bar. These bars are described in the crossbar chapter. Let's take a look at a simple example for the minimum deadband in the following waveform. When EPWM XA has a falling edge, there will be a delay occurring on the rising edge of EPWM XB. Likewise, when EPWM XB has a falling edge, there will be a delay on the rising edge of EPWM XA. For the illegal combo logic, each PWM will have one lookup table for A and one for B. This lookup table will take in a signal from another PWM module as an input to the lookup table. The lookup table allows you to determine an output based on the input combinations of N1, 2, and 3. For example, if N1, N2, N3 are all low, we will output a 1. If N1 and 2 are high and N3 is low, we will output 0. Another safety feature that was added was the event capture. This is within the digital compare submodule, and this feature will detect a missing edge in a configured time window determined by the X-min and X-max register. These registers are also shadowed and have three shadow register sets associated with them. If there is a missing edge detected between the configured time window, a trip or interrupt can be generated. A few other enhancements done to Type-5 PWM are linking deadband rising and deadband falling edge registers across PWM modules. Global load can now occur when time-based counter equals compare C up or down and when compare D is up or down. Within digital compare, the blanking window can be triggered now on a combination of certain events or together. For trips, there is a capture event signal that can generate a cycle-by-cycle or one-shot trip event. There is an additional signal that can be routed to the PWM and output crossbars as well as into the diode emulation minimum deadband illegal combinational logic submodules called trip out. Within event triggering, Type-5 has been modified such that multiple events or together can trigger a start of conversion A, start of conversion B, and interrupt events. Thank you for watching this video on the EPWM Type-5 feature set. That concludes the Type-5 EPWM feature set overview for the EPWM module on C2000 devices. Within our C2000ware, you can find examples showcasing Type-5 features.